Oke. Okay.
Any sound? Oke. Okay. Nah.
Preparing, still preparing, streaming. Ah, oke. Okay. Live and I record it. Oke, okay, Eki, you can take over.
Oke. Okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you everybody for coming and for watching this event through Sahabat Seni Nusantara YouTube channel. Today we are going to commemorate and celebrate one of the best directors in Southeast Asia, which is Ibu Yasmin Ahmad. And today is the 11th year of her passing, yeah, 25th of July 2009, and today is 2020. Before I continue with the discussion, let me explain about two things first. First of all, is about Haul. Not everybody knows and are familiar with the term Haul. Haul is a term from Islamic tradition, from the traditionalist school of thought. It is the way to commemorate and to celebrate the death of a person, usually important figures or clerics or ulama, every year. So today we will have like a cultural Haul because we will celebrate and commemorate one of the most important filmmakers in the Southeast Asia. Okay, and this event is being held by Madani Film Festival with the coordination with Sahabat Seni Nusantara. For those who doesn't know about Madani Film Festival, it's a film festival in Indonesia, in Jakarta, that celebrate the diversity of Muslim society, Muslim culture, and focus on the Muslim society. So it's about living Islam, about the Muslimness. And we started in 2018, every October, and this is our third year. But actually, in 2009, there was a small section about called Madani at Jakarta International Film Festival. And in 2009, I think it's 3 or 4 months after Yasmin Ahmad's passing, we screened all of the Yasmin's films, and then we had a book launching, Yasmin Ahmad Films by Amir Muhammad, and we invite Amir Muhammad to discuss the books. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, there were also Sharifah Amani and Orchid Ahmad joining the GFest, ya, Jakarta International Film Festival. Okay, today for the discussion, we will focus on Yasmin Ahmad and then about her legacy and about her influence towards filmmakers, actually particularly young filmmakers in Southeast Asia and also in Indonesia. But we also discuss about the memory and the achievement of Yasmin Ahmad as a filmmaker. And we have invited two speakers. The first one is Pak Hasan Mutalib from Malaysia. Apa kabar, Pak Hasan?
Baik.
Thank you. Thank you for joining us. And we also have Samaria Simanjuntak. Apa kabar?
Halo, Mas Samaria. Eki.
Are you in Bandung or Jakarta?
Di Bandung, Mas Eki.
Bandung, ya?
Iya.
Okay. The reason we invite two different person with two different background, because the first one, Pak Hasan, also known as the Malaysian film critic and Malaysian film historian, and also as well as filmmakers. And he knows Yasmin Ahmad in person, yeah, so we can discuss about the fond memory and something like that, and as well as the achievement. And at the other end, we have Samaria, the one of the filmmaker from young generation Indonesia, and we can we have two perspective, so we can make the rich discussion. Samaria directed Dua ya, dua. Cinta and Demi Uco. Ada satu lagi ya, aku lupa.
Ada yang mau keluar ini, okay. Guru-guru gokil, Mas Eki.
Oh, Guru-guru Gokil will be available on Netflix 17th of August ya. And satu lagi, itu ya, satu lagi horror horror movie ya.
Sesat.
Sesat. Yeah. Oke, okay. Yeah. Cinta and Demi Uco. And this is interesting because cinta with the T and the bracket and cinta Cina gitu ya, reminds me of it's just like I think it's full of Madani values, you know like it's like values of, you know, family and, you know, yeah, you should watch it by yourself. And Demi Uco, in Demi Uco there is one character named Umi Kazrina. As we know, Umi Kazrina is a character from the Percintaan Tan Homing ya, a very famous ad by Yasmin Ahmad. And Samaria, can you explain this? Can we watch the films online on the ATT?
Which one? Demi Uco?
Any of them? You can like Netflix.
Yes, Demi Uco you can see in some of the OTT platforms such as Viu and GoPlay.
Okay.
But Cinta, no.
Not yet, yeah.
No, yeah.
No, yeah. Okay. Okay, let's start the discussion with Pak Hasan. First of all, this is the very easy question, Pak Hasan. So how did you know Yasmin Ahmad for the first time and what was your first impression?
In the 1990s, when I was working in Film Negara, I was head of design. I was totally blown away by her Petronas commercial.
Which one?
Petronas commercial, TV commercial. And yeah. At that time, I didn't know that most of it was her work.
Okay.
And I was saying, if only this person could come into the industry and make feature films, we would have, you know, a real cinema. Okay. But of course, I never met her until when she made her film Rabun.
Oh, okay, Rabun.
That was meant for television. So we have a film club that was started in 1974, and I was a founder member, the only living founder member. All the rest are dead. So that's where I met her for the first time. And she asked me, what did I think of her film? So of course, I gave my frank opinion. I said, I haven't seen anything like this, this kind of TV drama in Malaysia. There are a lot of people who are going to hit out at you, and true enough, because it was something never done before. You don't see the characters, you only hear the voices speaking, things like that. So it was a big paradigm shift. So after that, I, of course, wanted to see her next film and so on. And when she did Sepet, I was invited to see the screening before. And I did comment to her a couple of times. She didn't listen. And then when Gobra came, the same thing, I said, there are things that you shouldn't put on the screen. I was not trying to censor her, no. But I knew she would get a lot of flack, and she didn't need that at the very beginning. But anyway, I think it's still okay. Then, of course, we became very good friends. And the moment it's edited, I would be the one she would call. She wanted to listen from me. What did I think? So I felt very honored.
Okay. So, did she ask your opinion, or did you get involved many times in her works, or you have like distance because you are also a filmmaker, or did you get involved in the process of her films as well? Or
No, I was never involved in her film, any of the making, and I think I only visited two times, one on Mohsin and the other one on Mualla. So I would just pop in. And I wouldn't say anything, just watch what she's doing.
And okay.
She's quite unique in the way she handled the production.
Okay. In your opinion, What makes Yasmin still relevant and important for today's generation, particularly in not only in Malaysia but I think in Indonesia and in the in Southeast Asia region? What is the recipe of her film that make her very lovable and so on?
I think you may know that Andrei Tarkovsky made a comment that film is like religion. Because there's something very deep, an objective, a higher objective that wants to be reached by the filmmaker. And I also say that cinema is spiritual. That's why my book on Malaysian cinema, the cover is yellow. So yellow is spirituality. In lighting, when you use yellowish lighting, you're talking about something spiritual. So now, she's always starts the film with the word Bismillahirrahmanirrahim.
Yeah.
In the name of God, the most merciful and most compassionate.
Yeah.
What she is trying to get across is, if God can be merciful and compassionate to us, why should not we have the same attribute, take over the same attribute, which is what Ramadan is all about? So then the question that he ran through all Muslims, and it was not just to show that, oh, here is a Muslim filmmaker. And I think that is why Iranian films also do that, but they have never talked about it. Now, her characters, I see that in Malaysian cinema, there are three filmmakers. They are basically following the same kind of, taking the same kind of approach. It was P. Ramlee at the very beginning, and then it was Mohammad Khalid.
Ahmad Khalid, yeah.
Then Yasmin Ahmad. All their characters are very, very ordinary characters who you probably can recognize that you know you have met in the street or in your own village and so on. So my favorite director, Yoji Yamada in Japan, is also the same thing. And when I introduced Yoji Yamada's film to Yasmin Ahmad, she was hooked from the very, very first film. Yoji Yamada made 48 films on one character. So I see Mohammad Khalid and also Yasmin Ahmad doing the same thing. Basically, the same characters are appearing and reappearing, sometimes with the same name. So I think this is quite unique in Asian cinema, where such a thing is happening. And maybe it's the reason why these three filmmakers are not really seriously taken, or rather not seriously looked into as to what they are actually doing. So as you know, in films, what we are seeing is a foreground story, but there is a background story running behind, which is the real nawaitu of the filmmaker. So to understand her film, you have to understand she herself, how she loved the parents and how she loved people. You know, here is a very unusual director. When a young girl, a school girl, speaks to her, she will listen. So she will pay attention. And the reason is, this is where she gets her ideas from. So you can see that you never, in her commercials, you see her very simple stories that, you know, you may have heard it from a friend or even you have experienced it yourself. So I think this is the one thing that is, I think we should pay attention to her. And her milieu, by milieu, I'm thinking of the environment of the client. Huh? Even though she's doing films today, but it looks like the milieu is the 1950s. So the outfit that she chose, like in Sepet, the old government quarters made by the British, and in Gugra, the old British style quarters and so on. So I think, and I did mention this to her, I think even though you did not live in the 1950s, but you had that feeling of what it was like in the 1950s, that everything was simple, people talk to each other, and people will just go over to the other house, there was no fence. And I think these are all the simple things that she's talking about. And I think that is why it is really reaching out to all of us.
Yeah, yeah. It is a new info for me about this, the 50s one. As far as I know, Yasmin always included many sharp criticism, cultural criticism, social issues, and so on, towards society in her works. Yeah, do you still the criticism still resonate there in today's society, especially in Malaysia? I mean about the what she criticized. Yeah,
well,
still Malay, happening. Mm.
Yeah, in Malay society, you do not criticize directly, and this is why P. Ramlee made comedies. And so he made dramas also. The criticism is always very subtle, because P. Ramlee was into self-disclosure. This is the Sufi element. He had a couple of masters, but it was informal learning. So he believed that when you criticize someone, you are in fact saying that you are better than that person. So P. Ramlee wanted to avoid that. But Yasmin Ahmad was not afraid of that. So, so sometimes she will let go. So I respect that, because you are what you are, and we cannot force you to be what you are not. So it's entirely up to you. But I think you have to do a lot of thinking before you say something that is going to be really subtle, in the way that Yasujiro Ozu, Mizoguchi, Aljit Rai, and all these people were making sure.
What about in today's society? Young people still remember Yasmin? Because I know there are like some books released and also a documentary about Yasmin Ahmad's work. Do people, especially the young generation, still remember and still watch, still celebrate Yasmin Ahmad in Malaysia?
Yeah, many of them who have never met her, who have never seen the film when they were screened, they are still watching it on DVD and on YouTube. And even lecturers in class, film lecturers, they are showing her film as an example of what are the issues plaguing Malaysia as far as race is concerned. And of course, that is quite a sensitive matter. And I think more non-Malays are reacting to her rather than the majority of Malays. But many of them are upset because they think that she is questioning the Malay special rights, like education and so on, which is actually something for us to think about. Because if a film does not bring about thinking about a subject, then I think the filmmaker is not a thinker. So filmmakers are thinkers. They should be able to express what they feel in whatever manner they feel like.
Yeah. And from what I know, Yasmin left like two unfinished projects. Yeah. Do you know what happened to the project? Is it what are those projects cancelled or other people, you know, take over or something?
Yeah. There was one for Singapore. It was called Go Radius, based on an athlete, I think.
Uh-huh.
It was already been planned. The other one is Wasuri Nagusa, a story set in Japan of a local girl going over there. So I read the script, it's beautifully written, and it is totally different from other films. It just flows. So she went to Japan together with Sharifa Amani. She can tell you probably the details. And she was so surprised that when they came to this place that they were going to shoot, they hadn't started shooting yet. There was just a formality. Yeah? So they had a table set and everything. It was so formal. You know, the Japanese like that kind of thing. And they had the Malaysian flag and the Japan flag in the background. Wow, it was wonderful. And she said that she visited Yasujiro Ozu's grave.
And they
had a very strange feeling. Now, I don't think Yasujiro Ozu is her favorite. And a critic, she was very upset when a critic compared her films to his style. She said, no. I said, of course not. It's more like Yodi Yamada style.
And Yodi Yamada.
That influence. Ghost Hideous, I don't know what happened to it. So once it's gone, I don't think anybody can take over the way that she wanted to do. And even Wasuri Nagusa also probably, I think, nobody can give her touch.
I heard about Yasmin's museum. at Inipoh, yeah, I think.
Yeah.
Inipoh. Yeah. Could you tell us a bit about the museum? Is it, yeah, of course, it's celebrating Yasmin's works, but can you tell me what, you know, if we go, if we visit the museum, what should we expect about the museum?
Okay. In Ipoh, you know, Ipoh is a very old town built on tin, and it is still old, and many expatriates have retired there because they love the environment. So it is right in the middle of the old town, and there are, you know, small eating shops here and there, and if you just take a shot, it will look like 1950s. Okay. Then on the first or second floor, I forget, I did give a talk once there, and it is all these faded walls that giving us a feeling that we are in a Yasmin Ahmad film. There are also photographs and so on, and not really much, but they are hoping to make it better with funding coming in so that they can have a proper museum set up. But for a start, it's already drawing people. And when people go down to Ipoh, so they usually head to the old town, the old area, and go to see the Konghin.
Was it located in the real shooting location of Yasmin Films, or not? Or in Ipoh, but not the real location?
So the locations where she shot are just within walking distance.
Oh,
not very far.
Okay.
The church is a bit far away, but the mosque and the the roadside and so on is quite near. And we you know, jovially does all these things, and we went on a walking tour from one location to another location, and I also chipped in to, you know, say this is what happened here. And the mosque, I think, is quite interesting because of that scene in Tarantine where the boy is praying, then suddenly two birds hopped in. And I asked her, how did you get these two birds to come in? He said, it's God's will. So we never expected. Suddenly these two birds just hopped in into the net. And you know, this young boy, he's very pure-hearted, he loves his mother and so on. So once you have animals or birds or something coming into the frame, that supports that, because in film, the use of animals shows that they have sixth sense and the person is a very pure-hearted person.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Pak Hasan. Last question. Have you watched the documentary, Yasmin San, and what do you think about the film?
Ah, yes, I saw, but I can't recall much. Because I was concentrating on something else. But I think it was done by this
Edmund Yeo.
Edmund Yeo. Ah, yes, yes. It was very well done. But I can't remember. Getting too old. I'm 75 already, you know.
Okay, thank you, Pak Hasan. And then we will get back to you. If people ask you question or after I ask question to Samaria, thank you. In the meantime, for the audience, if you watch via YouTube channel, please feel free to comment or to ask question in English or in Bahasa Indonesia. It's okay to either Pak Hasan or Samaria. Okay, sekarang ke Samaria nih. Nah. Tenang, kita. Nah, Samaria has different background, ya. Because have you met Kak Yasmin in person?
No, I have met Yasmin Ahmad in person. I started making film on 2009. So my first film festival is Jakarta International Film Festival of 2009 that Mas Eki mentioned before.
Okay.
I never met her in person.
But you watched the films at the G-Fest 2009 or in other occasion?
I watched her before. So Yasmin Ahmad blog is actually like my film school. So in 2007, yeah. I was still an architect working in Singapore, and mm-hmm. Yasmin Ahmad was like famous there in 2007, 2008. That's how I became aware of her name. So I actually read her blog first, then watching her films. And like what Pak Hasan said before, reading her blog is, you can feel that film is like a religion, actually.
Yeah.
I don't know if I mean it in the best possible way, but Yasmin Ahmad is like a prophet to me.
Yeah.
Like,
okay.
I still remember like her words, a lot of her words that motivate me and inspire me to make films. Because I wasn't trained as a filmmaker. Reading her blogs actually gave me the confidence to make the films, to make the story. And my first film was a very angry film. It's nothing like Yasmin Ahmad's film, but her words actually gave me the courage to express what I really felt. It's the first film I made. Its title is Cinta. It's screened in Jakarta International Film Festival 2009. It's about a Chinese boy falling in love with a Japanese girl, but it is nothing like Sepet. Sepet is a very wonderful, but my film was very angry. If you see the film, it's very angry. It's made by a 25-year-old angry non-Muslim girl. but it really was how I felt that day. So yes, I think in 2009 when Yasmin Ahmad passed away, even though I don't really know her, I don't know her personally, but it really broke my heart so much that she's like a real role model for me personally. Like even to these days, I still read her blogs, like trying to find inspirations, not only as a filmmaker, but also as a human being.
Yeah.
Her words really tell you how to live, like how to love. So I think that's why what Hasan said, simple things, how to love simple things. She not only inspired me to make films, she actually inspires me to scrub closets with passion. Scrub closets, you know, like do whatever you do with passion, even like the most mundane things.
By the way, did you get a copy of a book titled Yasmin How You Know? Because the book consists of like a compilation of her words. Yeah, very interesting.
Not yet, but my friend Sally Anansari, who also wrote Cinta with me, she promised to lend me that book. But because of the pandemic, it hasn't happened yet. But I'll remind her of that.
I think it's very interesting the book, because I think some of the content were from the blog, I think. And then the book was launched in Jakarta at Kino Forum, at one event in Kino Forum, and Ka Orket and Jovian came to Jakarta and discussed the book. Okay, but you should watch it. Read the book.
I think that
there is another book, but I haven't had chance to read. But I will ask Pak Hasan about the book and the shoebox. Yeah, maybe later. Have you watched all of her films and ads and short films? And what What was the first films that you watched?
The first film I watched is actually Mualaf, because it was screened in Singapore. Mm-hmm. That's how I was working in Singapore as an architect, and that's how I get to see her film. And later after that, then I get to see Sepet and all of her other films.
And at the movie theater or on DVD?
I think in film festivals, and I think film festivals. I think Jogja has it, and Jakarta International Film Festival also screen all of her films, right?
Mm-hmm. Okay, the next question will be about Umi Kasrinah that I mentioned earlier, yeah. Because this is interesting. It's just there is a character at Demi Ucok named Umi Kasrinah. Of course, suddenly I remember the Umi Kasrinah from Percintaan Tan Homing, and you mentioned your saudara idola gitu kan, your favorite director. So would you please explain about this, about the creative process?
Well, Demi Ucok is a lot of the story in Demi Ucok is actually autobiographical.
Yeah.
So the mother, the story is about a mother and a daughter who, the daughter doesn't want to become like her mother who forgets her dream, becoming an actress. The mother is played by my own mother. She became a real actress after Demi Ucok.
She won an award. Right?
She won award? Everything. She had like 3 awards at home. All best actress award.
Yeah.
Now she's like a legit actress. That was so funny. But the film, the main character who wants to be a filmmaker, she has a director that she idolizes. Mm-hmm. This director, I don't want to. A lot of the character was inspired by Yasmin Ahmad. Actually, the film itself is because I read her blog, right? And I thought to myself that the most important thing in your life is live by your passion. Go for your passion. But then I read in one of Yasmin Ahmad's blog, the key to success is be nice to your parents, which is something I cannot do because I was like in a very bad state with my mom, with my mother. So it was a very life-changing journey for me making the film, because I actually get to work with my enemy, my mother. But it was also like a fun experience. And then there is this director, and I didn't name her Umi Kasrinah. I named her Kasrinah Umi.
Oh, Kasrinah Umi. Oh, yeah. Kasrinah Umi. Oh, yeah.
So it doesn't get very similar. Then the line that she said is actually a line that I took from Yasmin Ahmad's blog. She said, the key to success is be nice to your parents.
Yeah, I remember that. Yeah.
And I think that's basically why I made that movie, so my mother can fulfill her dream to become an actress.
Nice. And did people like guess is that character is Ahmad, or did they didn't know about that? Is it just your homage or your trivia?
A lot of people in Indonesia aren't aware of Tan Hong Ming commercial, right? Mm-hmm. So not a lot of people that realize that. Usually only film buffs.
Yeah. Okay.
But yeah. I guess people in Singapore and Malaysia will know it right away when they hear the character's name is Kasrinah Umi.
So have you watched all of the films and the commercials, and Which one is your most favorite one?
Well, I think all of her films are my favorite. Okay. I don't know. I cannot pick.
If you have to, you know, to make a list, ranked, like, yeah, it's very difficult, right?
Yeah, it feels like I don't have the right, you know, like yeah. You're being anak durhaka if you like this one is better, you know.
Yeah. Okay. And if I'm not mistaken, in Demi Ucok, there are some scenes, yeah, related to pirated DVDs outlets, yeah, DVD bajakan, yeah.
Yeah.
Was that inspired by Sepet, because in Sepet the boy Jason is the owner of the pirated DVDs outlet, or is it something
actually
different?
I didn't think about it when I made that, but no.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, and the thing is, it's not only Yasmin, because I remember when you were in Singapore, you met Ho Yu Hang, yeah? Ho Yu Hang as well, yeah?
No.
Oh, bukan ya? Siapa? Then Matthew wanted to pursue the career in filmmaking. Because you were in Singapore, so you know about the scenes of Malaysian film.
I watched Ho Yu Hang's work and I love his work.
Yeah.
Yeah, but Yasmin, maybe because I follow her blog.
So, okay.
Yeah, Yasmin Ahmad is more like have more influence to me.
And you get curious. Who is that? Who is that man? Who is Mahasan? When you read the blog, yeah, and you want to know more.
Yeah. She mentions Mahasan a lot of times. I mean, a couple or three times she mentions Mahasan as well. There's a video of Yasmin Ahmad and Mahasan in talking about films. I think that also one of the first things that I watch before I became a filmmaker.
Mm.
Like how important emotion is.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. I think that the videos is one of the one of my film school as well.
Okay. Thank you, Samaria. Yes. Is there any? We will get back to you. We are now finding out whether there is a question at the YouTube channel or anybody. While we are waiting for the question, please feel free to put your question or comment in the comment section at the YouTube channel. Okay. There is one question. What are Samaria's favorite scenes from Yasmin Ahmad and why?
Okay. Of course, there are a lot of my favorite scenes from her films. But one thing that came to my mind is when the Ustad gave food to the dog. I don't remember the story that detail, but that scene, like giving food to the dog, it's I think it's like so loving. Like it's the thing that I get from her films is she never tells you like you have to do this, you have to do that. She never tells you what to do, but she just shows you the possibilities of being in a very loving and understanding environment, you know. So that is one of the scene that I remember. Also, that what really impacts me the most also how the family talks to the maid. The maid, you know how Indonesian and probably Malaysian are. I don't like how Indonesians treat their maids. But in Yasmin Ahmad's films, the way the family speaks to the maid like they are equals. Yeah, yeah. Like she never said, you cannot treat people or your maid differently or badly, but she shows us that there is another way of treating other people like this, like they're your equals, like it's supposed to be, and it's gonna make your life is actually a lot more enjoyable, a lot more fun, like the family. So I don't know, so many scenes from her films that really teach me a lot about life, not necessarily filmmaking.
Yeah, I guess you're right. Yeah. And thank you, Samaria. Pak Hasan, I have all of Yasmin Ahmad's film on DVD, except for Rabun. Is Rabun available on DVD or?
Yeah, or not yet? I have a copy on DVD. It's also on soft copy. Don't tell anybody, I might tell it
to you. But the thing is it, you know, is it commercially released, the Rabun, or?
No.
No,
It went to DVD.
Oh, okay. And then I remember I Googled to update about Yasmin's news and, information. And then I found out about this a new book. It's not new, actually. It's 2018. It's about I love you. Yeah.
I love you.
Could you please explain? Yeah. And the not only the book, but also the shoebox. So could you please explain to us about the new book?
Well, I think that thing often will be more relevant to talk about that because I didn't buy the shoebox. But both books was a very good attempt to collect the recollections of people who have known her or been inspired by her or whatever. Because I think this is something that is very important. Rather than have this interview and a long write-up, you just take all these anecdotes and just put them in a book. They become very interesting to read. So two or three of my anecdotes are there, and also two haiku that I've written. I've never written haiku in my life, but when she died, something came into my mind, and I put it in the book, both books.
Okay. And let's go get back to Samaria's doxin, ya. I think it's the doxin when in Mualaf, ya. In Mualaf, kalau nggak salah, yang on one scene the Dato was drinking alcohol, and the other scene he didn't want to touch the dog. Is that the scene? No, not that one. Not that one, ya. Okay, because you know, Pak Hasan, Yasmin's films created some controversials, you know, in Malaysia. For example, the dog scene, and then Sharifah Armani being, bold, botak, gitu. So, but you know, Yasmin always, took it very easy, like I don't care. And then, what do you think about that? I mean, did you talk about Yasmin about the controversial and discuss about how people reacted so aggressively?
I can say that in Malaysia there are many people who have very strange ideas about things that they do not know about. For example, dogs are Muslim.
Oh, in group, yeah.
Can actually rear dogs. And for either guarding the house or going for hunting and so on. And you can touch them, except if your hand is wet and you touch them, then you have to sum up 7 times. But there was this one entertainment editor who was totally against that dog touching scene by a guy who was going to switch on the lights at the mosque. And there was a public forum, it was on TV, and I was also on the panel. So the three panelists were all attacking her, and I was controlling my anger, and I was very calm. And because of that, my name went out very high on the internet for the whole month. The internet was on fire. They were attacking all these people. Mm. They were talking bad about her, saying that she's punishing the image of the religion, the image of the Malay culture, and so on. When actually, all of them are also guilty of doing it, especially this entertainment editor. If you have seen how he edits entertainment news, having a woman tak tutup aurat, and then male, female embracing each other, and so on. And he was promoting a bad film producer's film. So we have a lot of strange people in Malaysia, and it's getting stranger and stranger, by the way. And if Yasmin were around, I'm sure she would have a lot to say. So she was so naughty. As a film, I mean, she hit out at this entertainment editor, and she was very naughty, and I think she had a very sly grin on her face. You know, in Sepet, there's a scene where the sarong is pulled away, and we see Haris Iskandar standing there in his underwear. Mm-hmm. And you know what? He was attacking that one particular scene out of the whole movie. And Yasmin said, it was a 1.5-hour movie, and he saw nothing but underwear. So when she made Gubra, you know, there's a scene where this woman is hanging up, washing for drying, and it's a huge underwear. And he was facing camera. So that was her way of hitting out at this entertainment editor who was criticizing her over that. And even in the other scenes, she was commenting on, this is a little sensitive, I should not mention, but when I told her, she really laughed out a lot because I was the only one who had seen what it was about. Very, very naughty. I'll tell it to you personally.
Oh, okay. Hikmat told me that actually, because there is a dog scene in Mualaf and as well as dog scene in Gubra. What Samaria meant is the dog scene in Gubra, yeah, with the imam, yeah. Was this dog scene when, you know, imam going home after subuh prayer, and then I think he met a dog or something like that, yeah. Was it, you know, was the dog scene created a harsh response in Malaysia? I mean, the imam and very, you know, very familiar with the and you know with the dog and touch the dog and so on. How about was there any harsh response or something it came? Yeah.
Well, there were also comments from quite a few people who did not understand what the situation actually was. But you see, they missed the whole point. Now, this guy is not an imam. He's what we call Surya. The guy who looks after the small mosque, yes, called Surau, and he goes up the lights and so on. So you can see, very indirectly, what is he saying? He is a man who has seen the light. He switches on the light for people. Okay? And he pets the dog and he says, and the dialogue is very important, he says, don't lie down in the middle of the road or you're going to lose another leg or something like that, I mean. And then the dog listens to him, gets up and goes off, and we see that the dog only has three legs. So probably he got hit by a car or whatever. And it's like the dog was reacting to this man and understood what he was saying. But in Mualaf, he was making fun of all the people who were criticizing her. So here is a dato who drinks alcohol, but yet is, you know, is very sensitive to the dog being there. And that was another of Yasin Ahmad's very, very naughty criticism.
Thank you, Pak Hasan. Okay, is there any question from the YouTube channel or in this Zoom meeting? Or probably Samaria, you want to ask question to Pak Hasan, or Pak Hasan wants to ask question to Samaria?
Unfortunately, I've not seen a film, otherwise I would have something to say.
Samaria.
Okay, I think there was a question just now. about the element of Sufism.
Betul-betul. Can you elaborate your view about Sufi movies and how it applied to your takes on Yasin Ahmad? Or in other words, in my own word, can we consider Yasin Ahmad's films as Sufi movies, sir? Mm-hmm.
Yeah. There are no such thing as Sufi movies. All right. Now, he was very much into philosophy, literature, music, and so on. And she's a graduate in psychology, and she never studied film, just like Tamaria. So I remember once she criticized me in one of her, she had a column in the newspaper. And I told her about, I said that, you know, she was using film language and so on, so she got very upset. At that time, she didn't understand what was film language, but she was using it. Why? Because her background in literature and music, it just comes. So, in the first two films, she was trying to deliver messages. That is a no-no in filmmaking. You never deliver messages through film. You want a message, you send WhatsApp, or go to the post office. So if you watch all the classic movies, the films that are made by the great directors, whatever they want to say is very, very subtle. It's up to you to figure it out. So I did tell her about some elements in Sepet and Gubra that she was too blatant, but she didn't listen to me. But then when she had all that flack from Mohsen onwards, the moment the film is done, I will be the first to be called. And I had only one comment on Mualla. She was so upset because she had never reshot any scene, but she did reshot. I'm not claiming credit for it. I just commented. But the wonderful thing is, she did not change where the part where I had commented. She did something before. And then that particular scene worked. It was very strange. Now, the element of Sufism, Sufism is about self-disclosure, about going into yourself to discover who you are in reality. So, P. Ramlee had it in his films, but it was so really subtle. And it is in Pendekar Bujang Lapuk, the Raggedy Bachelor Warrior. Now, in Mohsen, you see the first hint of it in the flying, in the kite flying. That's a beautiful scene where all these people are out in the field and it's done in a long shot. Normally, you know, Charlie Chaplin said, long shot for comedy, close up for drama. He did totally opposite. So we see them in a long shot in the paddy field, all green, and they're flying with kites, and they had this beautiful French song. Even if you did not understand what the lyrics were, you could really feel something very deep. And then in Valentine, that scene where the girl, Indian girl, is dancing to the music of Qawwali. So the Qawwali is actually a Sufi song. Wow, that was really, really great. It was like asking the audience to come and lose themselves. Do not think. Just lose yourself in the music and watch the girl dancing. So that was very clever. So she was very much into philosophy. And she tried to find out for me a lot about Sufism, but because she did not have a master, I was not able to tell her many things. I only gave her hints. And then finally, I think she slowly began to understand that there is more in not saying than in saying something. That's Zen. And she was very much into Zen. And that's why we can see the elements of Sufism in her work in the last three pieces.
Have you written a piece about this thought? I mean, yeah, film Sufism, Sufism element in Yasmin's films, or
it's a bit difficult to write. There are things that cannot be said.
Yeah.
You know, even touching the dog, we are already jumping up and down. What else is that? Let's talk about the inner aspect of what Hamza Fanturi has been talking about, which is questions like which is the ocean and which is the wave? Which is the sun, which are the sun's rays? You see the sun through the rays, but The rates are not the same.
It's very roomy, yeah. Okay. Okay, it's like we have like 5 more minutes. Is there any last question or last comment? Probably. No. Okay. If not, we should end this discussion. Thank you very much, Pak Hasan and Samaria.
Thank you, Pak Hasan, Mas Eki.
Yeah. Thank you. And this is today is the 11th year of ya Kak Yasmin Ahmad passing for Muslims, please send the Al-Fatihah, yeah. And we can still also watch this video at the YouTube Sahabat Seni Nusantara, and then later we will upload it to Madani Film Festival YouTube channel. Okay, thank you everybody, and see you in the next event by Madani Film Festival. Thank you very much.
Thank you Pak Hasan, Samaria, kawan-kawan, makasih.
Assalamualaikum.
Stay safe, stay safe.
Yeah, stay healthy, stay healthy.
Stay
ya.
Healthy and stay safe.
Tematin lo.
Ya.
Oke, live-nya mat.
Ya, yeah. Oh bentar.
Oke. Okay.